Greta, but Gerwig.
Greta Gerwig. Yeah. I just did a movie with her.
I know. I saw that on your thing. Oh, yeah. On your lovely IMDb page.
Yes.
How are you?
I'm good. Yeah, I'm doing good. I mean, it's like, you know, this is like a wild time. I mean, the other night I was at the Governor's Awards. That's what it's called, right? Yeah, the Governor's
Awards. Pretty much,
yeah. that's how like much stuff is going on in my head right now. And I met some of my heroes, and the weirdest thing and like the new thing for me right now is that some of my heroes have seen my movie. So it's like, it's one thing to meet them, but to be known by them in some way, or to have, for them to be familiar with something I've done is even more surreal.
Mm.
Yeah. And especially because it's a movie I'm really proud of, that's even more meaningful. Like if they saw something I was really ashamed of, that would probably make me cower in fear.
This has been like a year-long love affair with this movie already.
It has been. It's been, and God, man, yeah, Sundance was like 7 months ago, maybe even now, six, even, more,
it
eight,
was
nine?
11 months ago. It
what?
Was 10 months ago. Yeah,
10 months ago?
It was January.
Oh my, wow. And it was, the movie finished like a year before that, too, so it's been a long time coming, this movie coming out, and premieres tonight, so that's exciting.
Did you see it as something that was going to be this event?
No, I didn't. I'm a young actor, but I've been in enough movies to have some perspective, and I feel like I've, when I first started acting, I sort of like would hope that I'd be in a movie that would be in like some award season stuff, and then as the years have gone by, it's that desire has sort of faded, and it's become more about the work. And when I was doing this movie, it was so demanding that I couldn't think about anything other than the work. And there was always, for the entire shoot, there was always another scene to shoot. There was always the next scene to film when I finished this one. And and because there was, yeah, it also just felt like we disappeared off into a corner in Manchester by the Sea and made this movie in a vacuum. Like it really felt completely separate from everything else.
So, acting, obviously, as you say, you're a young actor.
Mm-hmm.
How did this start for you? How did this become a thing?
So I acted in a play in seventh grade called Nicholas Nickleby, and I played the role of Smike, which is, Smike is like a small crippled boy who is abandoned. He's at an orphanage. He's like beaten by everyone.
a fun role.
Yeah. But I remember there was this one day where we were, it was a matinee. It's weird calling it a matinee. I was in seventh grade, but where I was performing and I had this monologue about how no one loves me. And in the middle of the monologue, I just burst into tears. And it wasn't like I just started crying, but it was as though I was confessing to my dad of all of the horrible things I'd done, and I burst into tears. And while the experience was happening, I was sort of almost like left myself and started watching. I was like watching myself as it was happening, and I was aware as it was happening that like, this is not usual. Like this, and I didn't think like I was the greatest actor on earth, but it was like, what's happening right now is not usual. And I've never seen it happen before, and I didn't even feel responsible for it. It felt like something that happened to me. And I got off stage, and my friend who was in the scene with me like hugged me and was like, oh my God, dude, like, did you see that? Like, you just burst into tears. But a casting director saw me, which is like, talk about, I mean, I don't know, coincidence. And it's how I got, I got an audition for a movie called Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close.
Mm-hmm.
And it came down between me and one other boy for that movie. But at the screen tests, there were monitors in another room where all the producers were sitting, and I auditioned, and in the other room was a man named Scott Rudin, who is the most powerful producer in the world, if you include theater and film. I mean, in my opinion, the most powerful producer in the world, and amazing man.
He agrees with you.
Yeah. but who has been just a wonderful man to me, and ever since that moment has taken me under his wing. Huh. And because of that is how I ended up getting Moonrise Kingdom. And that's how I got an audition for Moonrise Kingdom, which I got, and then I got agents, and I've been working about twice a year since then on different films, and my career was sort of just like I was doing minor roles in good films and Wes Anderson movies, which were a blessing, and then this movie came along, and I got to play an amazing part in an amazing movie.
So when you were doing the auditioning and you were, somebody was in the next room and their producers in this room and all that stuff, were you conscious of it at that point? Are you the kind of person who's conscious of it? Or,
you know, I remember that weekend. It was a weekend of rehearsal, of a very thorough weekend session. There were like six kids there from like all over the world. That's at least what I remember. And they had us doing art projects in some rooms and reading scenes in another. And it was just constant. There was constantly something we had to do. And I remember being really nervous and like I wanted it, but I didn't remember thinking that my performance in this audition could lead to anything other than me getting the role or not getting the role. Mm-hmm. It was either I got the role or I didn't get the role, and I was like in seventh grade, so I had no perspective. I didn't really know what was happening. I do remember though coming back after one of the day-long rehearsals into like English class, and like I sat down and I had told some of my friends that I was up for this movie, and they were like, they announced it to the class, and I was just like completely high on this like adrenaline, which was like, I'm special, like I feel special, and at least that's what it felt like as in seventh
right.
grade.
Yeah.
I could be in a movie. Yeah.
So do you feel special now?
it's interesting. I heard. I do feel special, but I don't think I'm. I genuinely think that everyone is special, and I just came from acting school. I've been training at an acting school, and I believe that there are dozens of kids, maybe not dozens, but a dozen kids at this school who are just as worthy of being in a position like this as I am. Like, actually dozens. And that's true of so many young actors and actors everywhere, that there are so many unknown talents and people who don't get recognition. And it's just timing. It's timing. Mm-hmm. And luck and being born into the right circumstances, and I'm incredibly grateful for this, and I'm not going to waste it. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to waste this blessing, but I'm very aware of the fact that I'm not the only person in the world who's capable of being received in a positive way by the public. Mm-hmm. And on top of that, like I'm aware that the next thing I do is going to be a disaster, and I'm gonna feel really bad about myself when that happens. But I'm gonna know that for the most part that it doesn't reflect my value as a human being.
Mm. Did you study before? Is this your first jump into studying acting, or had you been studying?
This going to school recently was the only formal training I'd ever had.
So did it feel good to have more training, or did it feel like you had already kind of developed a way of you working?
There were two experiences at this school, and one was my ego felt like it was being eaten alive at times when I was given criticism by teachers in front of a group of classmates who were all my age, because there's a part of me that was thinking, there was a part of me that had started to believe that I was more special because I was working. And I had to, for my sake, let go of that belief in order to engage with the training, because I can't work under the mindset of I'm more special than people. Mm. Because to believe that is, for me, that goes hand in hand with the belief that I'm less special than other people. And to hold, to cling to this belief is to live from fear. Mm. But the other thing that this acting school gave me is an emotional education. And I think the most important thing as an actor and as a human being is that the only reason I want to pursue any work is if it can lead me towards loving myself more and towards gaining more knowledge about myself. Mm. How deep can I go? How deep can I go? And how much can I learn about the world and what it means to be in this body, on this planet, at this time?
Is there any question about whether your life is going to be acting? Do you have other things that you're equally or similarly interested in?
I definitely, right now, acting is, this is what I want to do. I mean, 10 years from now, who knows if I'm going to be an actor. I think I would be doing myself a disservice to say that I'm going to be an actor for the rest of my life, because I don't know. But I know that I want to create pieces of theater with my friends, and there are so many ways in which I want to express myself. And I want to be a dancer sometimes. There's sometimes I feel like I'm not an actor, I'm a dancer. Like, that's like the seat. Like, I think I'm an amazing dancer, and I have, I don't have any dancing training, and I don't know how anyone would pay me to make a living as a dancer, but I think I'm actually a really special dancer. I don't know what that means, but, but.
Where do you dance?
With my friends. I had this amazing movement class at school, though. And it was really helped me understand like my potential as an I don't know what I'd call a movement artist. And you know what another amazing thing to do is, and this is something I do before I have a really emotional scenes in movies, is I play a song. I play a song that I connect with deeply, mm-hmm. and I just dance. I dance for the entirety of the song, and the one rule is that I can't let up. I don't let up. Mm-hmm. And the result is just a complete bliss and nakedness in mm-hmm. After it's done. And a feeling that I'm willing to share what I was afraid of sharing before. Mm. And that's not like to say, that's not like sharing a thing about myself. That's like going to a place in a scene, mm. which I couldn't have gone to if I just rolled out of bed in the morning and then just somebody called action. Like,
so as you got this character, did you
dance?
Well, did you dance? Do you dance for this character?
No, I didn't have that.
The thing yet?
I didn't have that wisdom at the time. I didn't.
How do you approach the actual work, though? I mean, do you?
Well, I'm just finished my first year of school, and I'm in a year off. So I've done mm-hmm. two movies since I went to school, and the thing I love about drama school is that it's. Just really quickly, it's like it's about exploring possibilities in ways, how many different ways in which can we engage in a process, mm-hmm. And not worry about the results, but just be with ourselves in this moment and like run run up and down a flight of stairs 30 times before we do this incredibly emotional scene. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have any of that before I did this movie. So a lot of this movie for me was just was going off of the Lucas Hedges technique, which was I was discovering as I went, which was just like I would try to create memories for myself, for my character, that would influence the way in which I walked into a room as Patrick. Mm-hmm. I was just constantly writing down things of memories I might have had, or what it might have felt like to have been in this experience, or what just happened. But so much of it was, so much of the stuff I did didn't, I mean, I was just trying to find what stuck, and a lot of it didn't stick. A lot of it was just me flailing, but fortunately I had Kenny there who saved me in what felt like every single day he was there to catch me.
Did you have a big, I mean, do you have a way of figuring out the history of the piece or how you're going to go? Because you're not shooting in order, obviously.
Oh, a way of figuring out the history of the...
Well, how you're going to go, how you're going to be, where you're going to be emotionally as you go through the script.
Yeah. I think I had some idea, and Kenny had some idea in his head of how he imagined it would have been. Like, that he mapped it out in his head that this scene is this level and this scene is this level. Mm-hmm. But he was also very clear that he wasn't sure. And that it would be a disservice to the story to be sure. Like, how can we know how I'm going to react when I see my dad's dead body in the morgue? That was a scene we did several different ways, and the one we went with was the one that we didn't plan on. So some of it is having an idea, but some general idea of the spine of the story, but some of it is being open to being surprised, because, I mean, how can I play Patrick and genuinely know how I'm going to react? It doesn't seem quite right to have an idea of that just doesn't seem like I'm doing any service to his story because going into it knowing I have an idea is. That's like assuming I know what it's like to lose my dad, and I don't know what it's like to lose my dad, and I won't know what it's like to lose my dad until I lose my dad. So you just have to go into the unknown in that respect.
So now what's fascinating to me about this particular scene. So did you have two or three kind of ideas of how you might play the scene going into the scene? Was it a conversation you had with Ken, or did you?
Of the refrigerator of the, scene?
Yeah.
Or of any scene?
No, that scene.
That scene was probably the one scene that it was like, we like going into it, we knew it was some sort of breakdown. But in terms of like, there was, the only way to figure out how the breakdown was going to occur was to just have a break, like was literally mm-hmm. just to have a breakdown. Like that's, you have to just have a breakdown.
So there wasn't like his idea and your idea and then the idea that ended up being
the only way it was going to work was if it literally happened, was if it happened. Mm-hmm. And the only way for it to happen is to not think about it. And because you just can't think about those things. They're like, it's like a breakdown is as individual as a snowflake. Like if I was to break through for real as an actor, it would be as multifaceted and it would flow like any other piece of nature. I mean, it's just unpredictable. Yeah. Yeah, you can't.
So when it happened, how did it, when what happened and that ended up on the in the film?
Yeah.
Happened. How did that feel?
Amazing. Felt so amazing. Yeah, man. I mean, cuz what it what acting can be for me is just think about all of the people who are holding the space for you in that moment, all the people who are listening, who are stopping to listen to what you have to say. Mm-hmm. And what better way to heal than to be heard in a moment of deep sorrow? And like to have a job where what you do will be seen by so many people, and if you can share a part of yourself that you haven't shared with anyone else, that's a kind of validation that goes way beyond anything superficial. It's actually not validation at all. It's just being seen for who you are and a release of fear. Yeah.
Is that what you want from this? From acting?
That's what I want from every single moment when I'm living for myself and not for an idea I have in my head of who I am and what I want my life to be. That's what I want. That having been said, I think that there are many different ways to be seen, and you don't always have to just cry your eyes out in order to be seen. That's sort of like that's not the best way to live your life. You can laugh and you can sing and be seen. I mean, you can look someone in the eyes and be seen. You can so many different ways. But that's one way. And as much as I can be seen and see other people, there's this great Philip Seymour Hoffman, or his quote in Almost Famous, where he's like, the only true currency in this world is when two people are being uncool together. And I think I think one way of being uncool is actually just being honest. At least this is turning into like a 60 minutes talk. I feel like this is like my 60 minutes. It's like Lucas Hedges talks about his deepest secrets. I feel like I've spent so much of my life trying to be cool and trying to not literally be the cool guy. No, like that's dumb. I don't want to be the cool guy. I want to be cool. I want to be and cool in ways that aren't necessarily obviously cool. Like I want to be cool in that I can be self-deprecating, and that's a really cool thing to be, but it's not what you would believe as stereotypically cool.
Right.
I want approval, but I don't want to live my life like that anymore. I want to live my life for myself, and that just means taking the risk of not looking cool in front of someone all the time, whenever necessary.
So are you an old soul, or did you, I mean, is you're, you know, year and a half older, 2 years older than you were when you made this movie?
Yes.
You're older than you were when you started doing this. I mean, at this age, people go through enormous changes year to year, and they're, you know, just big growing up. It's part of the thing. Is that also true of you? Is the world a different place 2 years later than it was 2 years ago?
Or? The world it could not have done more of a 180 than what it was. I mean, when I was a senior in high school, I was convinced that my generation is the most destructive and ugly generation in history, and that humans have no free will, and that everyone is dying, and all of these incredibly negative beliefs, which are really just came from reading too many sci-fi novels and taking one too many philosophy classes at a liberal arts school in Brooklyn where you don't have that much perspective. But I never really took some time to experience something for myself and to like plant what if I just went into my backyard and planted something? Like, what does that feel like to plant something?
Mm-hmm.
So in the last year or 2 years, I think the shift hasn't been necessarily in my perspective, but in my intention, which caused a shift in my perspective. And the shift in intention is to experience things in my body, not experience things in my mind.
Mm.
And because I look outside right now and I actually see I see the world, and I see a lot of green trees, and I see a living, breathing person right in front of me. Our minds can make us believe. I can look outside and I see a bit of smog and I go, oh my God, I mean, in 10 years from now, I'm going to die of heat, I don't know, stroke. And I can live my life like that, or I can actually be grateful and mm-hmm. happy that I'm here and plant a seed and just actually be here for my own life and for myself.
Mm. So going to school this year, is that a taking time off and working on yourself choice as much as it is?
You mean not going to school this year?
No, the fact that you went to spend a year going to school, because I'm sure you could have worked through it, or maybe you did work through it.
My intention on going to school actually wasn't the intention I left school with. It was like I went to school to become a great actor so that I could secure my place in this industry for the rest of my life. That's no longer my intention. My intention is to do whatever I can to make myself I can do whatever I can to love myself.
Mm-hmm.
And if that means having a career, if that means pursuing this kind of work, then that's what I'll do. I'm open to whatever, but I have a feeling that this is the work that I'm supposed to do. But I went to school because I ultimately thought I wasn't good enough to have a career.
Mm.
And I thought that if I went to school, I'd become good enough and I could leave school and everything would be solved. All my problems would be solved because I'd finally be a really good actor.
So you came out with something much better than acting lessons.
I came out knowing that there's no place that I can go to and no person who I can meet that can save my life. In all honesty, if you had told me several years ago that I'd be doing this press tour and and all of these amazing things, I would have believed that my life would be complete. And I can tell you right now that the results from the work that I've done on this movie and the way that this movie is being received does not complete my life. It's a beautiful part of my life, and it is a part of my journey towards, I guess. Giving myself what I need on a daily basis in order to be be most here. How can I be most here? And no one thing can give me that. And this movie the experience of making this movie is a big reason why I've come to this conclusion.
Mm.
Yeah.
So you're working through it all.
Yeah, I'm very much in the process right now. Yeah.
But it sounds like this is, you know, you. It sounds like you have some perspective on the good thing that's happening and lack of fear of what's coming next.
Yeah, man. I can tell you, though, that, like, admitting all of these things makes it so much easier for me to stand up in front of a group of people and talk.
Mm.
Like, to...
As yourself.
Yeah, I mean, I used to have, when I got that play, Nicholas Nickleby, I found out I got the role, I was praying that I was would get a court, like an ensemble part. And when I saw I got the role, I ran outside and I cried. And like I ran to my mom and I burst into tears. Because, and then she walked me around the block and I was convinced that if I did it, I would make a fool out of myself. Mm. And because my face would be red the whole time. And a few years earlier, I had played Puck in Midsummer Night's Dream, and the rehearsals had been amazing, but when I did the performance, I couldn't, like, I was in the middle of my monologue, and I started tying my shoe because I was so scared, and because my face was so red. And I just can't tell you what it feels like to be an actor and to not be afraid. It's an amazing thing.
And you got to play with Greta.
Yeah, and I got to play a musical theater actor in that, which was, yeah, that was actually one of the most profound experiences of my life. I mean, I'll talk about this when the movie comes out, but I do a monologue. Oh, I'll talk about it when the movie comes out.
So was the experience of Greta as a director very different than Kenny?
Very different. Greta, like, was constantly playing, like, Fleetwood Mac on set, and it was a totally different vibe, and no one is more valid than the other, but we were making different movies, so each film required a different set.
But a pleasure to hang out in hippie land with Greta.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, Greta's somebody who I can talk like this. I can talk about... We had some amazing conversation before we did that movie just about where we are at in our lives and what we're afraid of. And I wish that there was the film industry right now was much less traditional in its approach of making movies. I wish that, like, before every day, like, people like danced naked around a fire. Like, I mean, not really, but
no, you can find that movie.
But you know, I heard Alejandro Iñárritu, like, threw, like, he like held hands with the whole crew before Birdman, and, like, they, like, threw roses into the I don't know what they did, but I just think that there are amazing ways to create things, and Kenny's one of the people who's tuned in to how to engage in a process in a way that isn't necessarily what you'd expect.
So for you moving forward, the company you keep will be as important to you as the role you play is.
Totally. Like. But it's also like, I can't expect any group of people to provide an environment for me. I walk into an environment and I'm responsible for whatever it is for me. I'm the only person who perceives, like, I walk out onto a stage and I can perceive the group of people watching me as terrifying, as scary, mean people who are there to hurt me, or I can see that they're just there to listen to me and that they're inviting me into the space to talk to them. And so, yes, I do want to choose the people I want to work with wisely, but I also want to be very clear with myself how I want to live my life and do my work.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Have a good one.
Thank you. You too. Yeah.